Sixto Wagan. I'm the director for the Center for Art and Social Engagement here at U of H. And as organizations that speak about place and communities, we would like to acknowledge the original inhabitants of the land in which we gather. The city of Houston and the Gulf Coast region is within the traditional territories of the Sanaa, Atakapa, and the Karankawa peoples. We acknowledge this land's occupied, unceded territory, and pay tribute to them. We also recognize Native peoples that share the Southeast Texas region, including the Tankawa and the Coahuilan peoples. So we are grateful that you are here joining us on this, the final public event of our 2018 fellows. And we're also grateful for the support of the Catherine G. McGovern College of the Arts, Dean Andrew Davis, and to Suzanne Deal Booth, who gave the lead funding to support the fellowships.
So our fellowship is a partnership between Project Row Houses and the Center for Art and Social Engagement at the University of Houston. So I just want to say thank you to Sixto, who is my collaborator and co-conspirator and agitator in so many different ways. I also want to say thank you to the College of the Arts and the University of Houston just for participating and being a partner in this. And also to all of the people who served as Brain Trust members to our fellows. The Brain Trust are basically additional extended members of a kind of mentorship circle. And to all the people who offered kind of informal and formal conversations along the last 10 to 11 months. The fellowships are really opportunities for us to promote research in the field of socially engaged art practices by cultivating questioning, listening, observing, and engaging with communities. So unlike maybe most fellowships or residencies when we invite artists to come in and do specific projects, we are really trying to promote the idea of spending time and really building up ideas and questions and kind of building up the networks and communities that they're working in. So that's a really kind of important value for us, and I think it's a really critical moment and time to think about that for artists as they engage deeper with communities and engage deeper with place. So without further ado, we're going to introduce Regina Agu, who is up first.
Great.
Psychogeography of Emancipation part. And so what I'm going to talk about today are some things that have emerged from that research, kind of focal points that I'm going to continue to delve into with the remainder of the fellowship year and afterwards. I'm definitely looking at this as like kind of a phase one of a larger project that brings together a lot of things I've been interested in previously in my practice and pushes them forward in new ways.
Hello.
past year, I've had the opportunity to engage in a deep dive into the history and legacy of Emancipation Park and Third Ward Houston. When I began the fellowship, I was excited to bring the concerns of my studio practice and collaborative projects from the past few years into this research. I use a variety of tactics in my practice, drawn from critical geography, conceptual writing, and poetry, and I also work through archives and archival practices. Although not exclusively, I'm particularly interested in the complex relationships between the landscapes and geographies of Black communities and other communities of color along the Gulf Coast region in the U.S. The audio clips that you just heard were part of a previous investigation into the sonic landscapes of Third Ward, landscapes of celebrations and of community gatherings, and how those sonic landscapes are not necessarily bound by physical geographic delineations determined by the forces of urban planning and redevelopment. The first was audio that I took of the TSU Ocean of Soul, recorded during a performance of the Waves Squad Dancers in November 2016 in downtown Houston. And the second was from the Emancipation Park rededication in June of last year, in which drummers and African dancers took to the stage as crowds of onlookers gathered to celebrate the newest iteration of the park space. I'm starting out with these two clips to invite you to think with me about sound as part of this landscape, to think about the compression and expansion of time and histories and how that can be traced through sound. How sonic landscapes can map traces of celebrations, community memories, and community dreaming. But most directly related to this presentation in this year's research, I'm thinking about how those two audio clips form part of the psychogeography of Emancipation Park through the movement of the park's constituents and the echoes of the park's history into the present. But more on that later. Emancipation Park has long fascinated me as a unique case study for looking at the manifestation of Black radical imagination in public space in Houston and beyond. As an artist that looks to Third Ward as my creative home since relocating to Houston, I've witnessed the transitions of the park from the mid-2000s onwards, including its use by the community prior to its closure for redevelopment, and then its transformation and reopening with a recent $30 million investment from the city of Houston. This presentation will focus on a few areas of my ongoing research that have emerged as focal points during this period of independent investigation, stemming from conversations with constituents of Emancipation Park, past and present, from attending community meetings such as the Third Ward Community Clock, among others, and thanks to the guidance of my brain trust, which are Michelle Barnes of the Community Artists Collective, Troy Bidden, who's here, a friend and researcher and writer, and Gary Weiss, who is also a writer who looks at art and Black imagination. Some guiding research questions throughout my year have been, can we imagine a sustainable constellation of urban green spaces, such as parks and community gardens, that are dedicated to celebration, liberation, and emancipation of Third Ward and beyond? What do safe, healthy public spaces for residents of color look like across Houston? What happens when urban green spaces are developed and programmed with feminist, women-centered design principles in a Black radical context? What do urban green spaces look like when choreographies and sites of mass congregation, including demonstrations, protests, and dissent, and celebrations for residents of color are encouraged instead of policed? And what role can community memory and dreaming play in reimagining Houston's urban green spaces and the role that those spaces play in Houston's growth into the future? So out of these questions, a few focal areas have emerged. I'm going to start with one. The history of images. So when I first began my research into Emancipation Park, there were two images that stood out in my mind. Two images that I was very familiar with that I'd seen circulating online through news stories that were related to, at the time, the park's closure and its since redevelopment, and then through talking with other artists and researchers that have looked into the park's history before me. And so this first image is the one that kind of immediately jumps into my mind when thinking about the history of Emancipation Park. And it was taken in, actually it was a Juneteenth 1880, And it shows community members at Emancipation Park, including one of its founders, which is Reverend Jack Gates. And then this is the second image that is really familiar to me and probably to other people that are interested in kind of the looking at the way that the park was used in the past. This photograph was taken in 1908 of two daughters of Reverend Yates, and they were Martha Yates Jones and Pinky Yates. And this photograph shows the two women dressed up on their way to attend the flower parade celebrations that were occurring at the time in commemoration of Juneteenth. As I said, this photo was taken in 1908, which had been about 20 years after the previous photo. And the house in the background was the Jones House, which was built in the 1890s in Fort Worth, Houston, and demolished around 1964. So the reason that I'm bringing these two photos up, not just because they're part of what drew me in as a younger artist into thinking about Emancipation Park in this way, but also recognizing that it's very hard to separate the histories of Emancipation Park from that of Juneteenth, and recognizing that Juneteenth celebrations are deeply embedded into the psychogeography of Emancipation Park. So I'm going to briefly as I can, go through the history of images, because I realize maybe not everyone is as familiar with the history of the park, and then from there get kind of deeper into some of the research that I've been doing, in addition to looking at archival photographs. So just briefly, Emancipation Park was founded in 1872 by Richard Allen, Richard Brock, Jack Yates, and Elias Dibble. And the men were led by Jack Yates, who himself was a newly freed and formerly enslaved person. And the four of them made a collective land purchase of about 10 acres of land for between $800 to $1,000. The men were members of the Antioch Missionary Baptist Church and Trinity Methodist Episcopal Church, and they formed the Colored People's Festival and Emancipation Park Association, and through the land purchase manifested the vision and forethought to establish a permanent home for Juneteenth celebrations. And for those of you that may not know, Juneteenth commemorates the day when General Granger and 2,000 Union troops read the Emancipation Proclamation in Galveston, thereby enforcing the liberation of 250,000 slaves in Texas. And this occurred a full 2 years after the actual end of slavery. So Juneteenth was a very special day for people in the African diaspora, and the original Juneteenth, of course, commemorates Galveston, but as you may be aware, around the country now, Juneteenth is celebrated nationwide at this point. And so initially, the park was only open for Juneteenth celebrations due to the fact that the founders did not have enough money to maintain the park year-round for public use. And so, however, the Juneteenth celebrations that were started by the founders continued on an annual basis. So the flower parades themselves have an interesting history as related to the park and thinking again about the psychogeography of that site. So what else was happening when the flower parades were going on was Houston, if you're familiar with the term Natsuo, this actually goes way back to the beginning of the 1900s, where at the time, it was very popular, I guess, in Houston to bring bright things backwards. So Natsuo is actually a series of celebrations that first started in 1899 as a way of attracting tourists and capital and investment into the city. So basically, the kind of captains of industry and high society people in Houston would get together to host this festival, which included parades, a football game. There was a king and queen, King Natak, which is King Cotton backwards. So they were actually commemorating the cotton trade in Houston. And this kind of had ripple effects throughout the city and was known as like a really kind of riotous time. And World War I is actually what probably closed all of, kind of got the people to move onwards from the festival, but I think the last one was maybe commemorated in 1913. So prior to Natsuo, there actually was an interracial festival that black citizens in Houston were invited to, which was the fruit, flower, and vegetable show. However, by the time you get to the kind of when Natsuo was in its heyday, black people were no longer invited to participate in any of the festivities unless they were servants attending, people that were actually involved in the celebration. And so in response to that, black communities in Houston, including those who were members of 3rd Ward, 4th Ward, and that were involved in Emancipation Park, said, okay, we're going to have our own festival. And that was called the De La Lot Festival, which is colored backwards. And it was the started by the De La Lot Carnival Association, founded by John Matthews, William Jones, and Manny Keegan. So this is some of the memorabilia that you'll see from the kind of white festival. And as I was doing this research, the photographs of the De La Lot Festival are actually very few and far between. Part of that probably had to do with the economics of the time and also access to photographic equipment. So it's a lot easier to find the remnants of what was happening in Natsuo and not so much Emancipation Park, which is what makes the remaining photos of the flower parade so special for that reason. And also something to keep in mind is that part of the Dareluck Carnival Association. So there, as I said, Natsuo had cane and cotton. The equivalent on the Black Community Celebration was cane loyal service. I'm not going to try to pronounce that backwards, but you can. And so it was actually a prominent attorney, M.H. Goyles, who was the cane, that initiated the celebrations in 1909. And that has significance in bringing all of that up for a reason. So again, festivals from Natsuo, this is the equivalent. You see kind of like high society white women that were on the parades, the flower parades, and in contrast, what was happening with in 4th Ward and 3rd Ward at the time. This is interesting because the library does have documents that do announce kind of the social clubs in Houston that were both black and white. And so this is from 1909, and you can actually see, well, you can't see here, but if you look in the first column towards the top, you can actually see the De La Lot Carnival Association mentioned in this publication as an official club that was starting up to kind of and launch these parades. And so the park, Emancipation Park, was the home of the first De La Lot Festival, and the flower parades would progress from 4th Ward on to 3rd Ward and concluded the park where Juneteenth celebrations were held. And so also around this time, the Red Book of Houston, which was a compendium of social, professional, educational, and industrial interests of Houston's colored population, that's the full title, came out in 1915. And the reason that ties in so well, again, into thinking about the psychogeography of Emancipation Park, is that not only were the festivals and the community organizations involved in those celebrations mentioned in the Red Book, but the Red Book itself had placed a very high emphasis on land ownership. Churches were part of that, definitely. But thinking about prominent black citizens in Houston and the legacies of land ownership and professional development, which were very much part of the initial impetus for purchasing acreage, because the ability to even purchase land was brand new for black citizens at the time of the founding of Emancipation Park. And so Reverend Yates and his cohort in purchasing that land were also newly exercising that right as a very radical gesture of what was then white Houston. Thinking about the history of images though related to the park and thinking about kind of the incompleteness of the archive. So this is in a book that I own, actually, which goes into more of the history of the festivals. But then you can begin to see, so on the page that's kind of turned, you can see kind of the edge of a white prominent family. And so this is, as those sorts of celebrations were going on, you can see a range of Black women who are in charge of housekeeping and childcare while the prominent families were participating in festivals such as Matsuo. So the reason that this photo is so interesting to me is I kind of, I'm very curious to see where more of these images are held in thinking about the third ward and fourth ward communities, because as part of the Red Book of Houston and thinking about these ideas of Black social and economic progress, I wonder where women like these would have been included basically in either side of that, either side of those considerations. So that's something that I'm looking into as well. As the research goes on. So, Emancipation Park, as the flower parades, you know, kind of died down with time, the park itself went through several changes, and so this is a softball game that is being held in the 1950s. So at this point, the park had been donated to the city in 1916, changes to the tax code allow for that donation and allow for the park to then begin to be developed with some infrastructure, like softball courts, different grounds that people could visit, and were and the park was then open for longer than Juneteenth as city money came in and allowed for that development to take place. And then in the 1930s, the WPA constructed the park's community center building. Emancipation Park has also hosted a range of civil rights gatherings, celebrations, and demonstrations, as seen here in some photos also from the 50s and 60s. And this legacy of Emancipation Park is tied to Houston and political change, continued on through the 80s. There's several photos of Jesse Jackson and Mickey Leland organizing people at Emancipation Park as part of the Decaucus Day, which would have been in mid to late 80s. And then these are just stepping back a little bit, but from the 70s, you can see children that are playing on what was then kind of the play area that had been purchased and developed as part of the park's infrastructure. This is an image that I'm very curious about. I've only found one of it so far, but there apparently was an outdoor mural and billboard that was installed in the Emancipation Park. I have no idea who the artist or the painter was, but it was an installation of prominent Black Americans that was on site. This photo is from 1975, and I have not been able to find any other record of it, so if anyone has any leads, please let me know. But by the time I first encountered Emancipation Park, this is more or less what it looked like in the mid-2000s. And so you can see there was a recreation center. There had not been too much development that happened to the park after the 1970s for a variety of reasons. You know, once the board started to go through its own challenges due to, for example, the construction of 288, due to desegregation, due to an emptying out of the neighborhood in terms of jobs and economic opportunities, the park itself suffered because of that. And so although there was maintenance of the facilities, there wasn't really much modernization of the park after the 1970s. And so the buildings that you see here were, although, as I remember them, were very accessible and in good use, but it wasn't really modernized compared to a lot of other green spaces in the city. And so just thinking about that brief history of Emancipation Park, something that I've been thinking about are this idea of constellations of emancipation. So Emancipation Park in Houston is not the only Emancipation Park in the state of Texas, and it's not the only Emancipation Park in the Western Hemisphere. So one thing that I started to think about was what made Emancipation Park in Houston itself a unique park? What was it that kind of allowed Houston's Emancipation Park to flourish in ways that the other parks have not been able to. And so some examples are parks in Mejia, Texas, Austin, Kingston, Jamaica. They're actually was an Emancipation Park in, for 1 year only, 2017 to 2018 in Charlottesville, Virginia. And then thinking about ties of Emancipation Park to Chicago, which actually goes pretty deep. For example, Reverend Gates opened up a school for colored children in Fourth Ward, and it was actually co-founded and co-funded by a women's group that came down from Chicago to help them do that. And so you begin to see, not only in the current ties between Emancipation Park in Houston and, for example, Chicago's extremely elaborate Juneteenth celebrations, which I was able to participate in this year, because I happened to be in Chicago for Juneteenth instead of Houston. So you begin to see that kind of legacy and that communication happening back and forth over a 100-year period. And then also going to bring New Orleans into this constellation because of two conferences that I was able to attend this year, thanks to the fellowship, the American Association of Geographers, and then the ASAP-10 conference, which was the Association for the Study of the Arts of the Present, where I was actually able to give a much lighter, smaller version of this talk in October. Next year has the Booker T. Washington Emancipation Park, which was founded in 1898, so it is itself also a very early park, but as you can see from the photo in the background, it's pretty empty. So when you compare what happened in, and I'm sorry, it's not Mexia yet, I've been corrected on this, it's Mexia. sorry. So you can begin to see, although there were commemorations happening in other parts of the state, when you look at the legacy of Emancipation Park itself, and this is due to this is not by accident, especially in a town that gentrifies and redevelops as violently as Houston does. This is definitely due to sustained community effort by groups such as Friends of Emancipation Park, which definitely rallied to get the park redeveloped in the 2000s, and now the Emancipation Park Conservancy. But you can get a sense of what would have happened if things had gone, kind of taken the path that parks in other parts of the state had. So the other reason this park is significant in my research is that, unfortunately, the Comanche 3 actually took place at the site, which I was not aware of, but in the 80s, at a Juneteenth celebration, there were three young black men who drowned while under mysterious circumstances while being arrested for possession of marijuana by the police, and that actually occurred at the site. This is a photo of Emancipation Park in Austin. And so again, you get a sense of what kind of the range of what the range of commemorative experiences and landscapes looks like when it's tied to the idea of Juneteenth and emancipation. Actually, Austin is now finally in the process of designating this park as a historic site, but it's already been purchased by private developers who have made it clear that they have no intention of preserving this land. And oddly enough, there is an Emancipation Park in Kingston, Jamaica, which was actually just founded, I think a few years ago, 2002. And so this is a statue commemorating that site. Prior to this, apparently this site was a dust bowl, but due to organization by citizens, by the city of Kingston, and by artists, it's now cleaned up into a really remarkable site that you can visit that has this profound statue by an artist named Lord Facy. It's an 11-foot statue commemorating emancipation. Here are these two figures. And then, as I mentioned, Charlottesville, Virginia did have an Emancipation Park for just 1 year. Charlottesville should be in everyone's memory because of what's been happening lately. But so essentially, there's a statue of Robert E. Lee. This park was purchased in 1917 for Robert E. Lee Park. And then in February 2017, City Council voted to remove the statue, and there was a lawsuit, and then there was the Unite the Right rally, and which turned out to be very violent. And this year, it is now named Market Street Park, and the statue is covered in a shell. And so this kind of brings me to the, where I am now in the research. So I have been thinking about, again, this idea of psychogeography and going on to think about the idea of black geographies and speculative futures. And so, as I mentioned, I had the opportunity to attend a couple of conferences in New Orleans this year, thanks to the fellowship and being introduced to the conferences through other artists, such as Tia Simone Gardner, who's not here, but we actually met in New Orleans, and she recommended that I attend the AAG, which completely blew my mind, and I think my work and my research is, it was a transformative moment for me, for sure. But encountering the specialty group of black geographies, which are a group of researchers that are theorized around the work of people like Catherine McKittrick and George Lipsitz, and they have the idea that black matters or spatial matters. And so the field of geography is essentially being theorized through black geographies as looking at, for example, geographies of incarceration in the United States, or geographies of public space that are related to black communities like Emancipation Park, geographies of surveillance, of policing, and then also geographies of celebration and tourism like New Orleans and other cities in the South. And so being in that room and being able to have my ideas discussed along with this other research was really profound. And really kind of sharpen the way that I was thinking about how Emancipation Park ties into this idea of black geographies, not only in Houston, but beyond, as you can see the kind of ripple effects that Juneteenth and Emancipation Park have across the black imagination in the United States as a whole. And thinking about psychogeography, which is a familiar term to me, but I'm sure a lot of artists in the room, but psychogeography, in a sense, comes out of an avant-garde movement in Europe, actually, in the 1950s. It was defined by Guy Debord. But it's this idea of roaming or drifting or moving through a city in a way that allows you to rethink the conditions and the mental space or awareness that you have awareness that are formed by city development and these external factors. And although there's a lot to critique about psychogeography in terms of it being an avant-garde movement and the class assumptions that go along with that, one reason that I look to it in thinking about my research is I do think if you think about encountering Emancipation Park not just as a public park site and through the redevelopment and structures, but also thinking about it as a very forward-thinking, radical exercise that the founders thought about in the 1870s, and looking at the lasting impact of that one collective action of purchasing land, you can definitely see how Emancipation Park not only ties into speculative futures, but using psychogeography as a tool to kind of peel back the layers of that history has been very empowering to me and has resulted in a lot of interesting research through the fellowship. And then the last thing I'll kind of close with is this idea of speculative futures, which is what I'm going to take with me in the remaining month of the fellowship and beyond, because as I said, this work is definitely going to continue next year, as I'm now starting to think about ways to respond through, for example, photography, through movement, through some of the video work that you saw at the beginning of the presentation. But this idea of thinking about urbanism and speculation through black geographies. There's a researcher named Mackenzie Wark, who teaches at the New School, who has this idea of, for example, the infrastructure city, which I found to be really interesting in thinking about Emancipation Park in Houston. But she asked the question, if one thinks backwards from the experience of infrastructure, how might that be structured differently to enable other kinds of city? So in thinking about Emancipation Park, if one thinks backwards from the legacy of the land purchase, of the celebrations, of the different histories, and thinking about Emancipation Park as a real-life practice of Black life, resistance, and survival through celebration and through this ongoing legacy. What can be learned for the city? What can I learn as an artist? And how can those principles be applied in thinking about the growth of Houston going forward as gentrification continues to encroach on Third Ward and is actually being, how to prevent Emancipation Park from being weaponized in that fight against the very community that founded it. And thank you.
We have some time then for questions for Regina. Be shy. That was a lot, but I'm sure that there is a lot for you all to ponder. Any questions?
I wonder if you can talk about kind of how your work has shifted when you talk about these moments of transformation. I was wondering if you could talk about visually and poetically, you know, how your work has shifted, if any, during this past year.
When I came into the fellowship year, I had been thinking a lot about, for example, landscape photography, something that I've been working on over the past couple of years, and kind of looking at different areas of Houston, like Third Ward, like other places where I lived, but then also Galveston, for example, because of this kind of thinking about the ties between Galveston and Houston, as an example. But something that I think the fellowship period, and especially going to the AEG conference in particular, really sharpened for me, was thinking about that work as part of kind of a larger field of interdisciplinary study and inquiry. So it's not only that I'm making these images, but thinking about how these images are situated in the context that's really kind of looking at not just the history of images, but what it means to produce images of a person that is rooted in these landscapes. And looking at the images as a way of opening up further inquiries in an art context, but then also thinking about the impact of images and imagination in a very real sense. Thinking about, for example, Emancipation Park as being kind of a small gesture that's just had these really kind of far-reaching, rippling consequences. Not just in the way that that neighborhood and that the hyper-local area around Emancipation Park now interacts with the site, but as I tried to show in the presentation, how it ties into the imagination of other communities and how we interact with the land and landscape in those places. And so, I think that these are all things that I was interested in, but through Black geographies, in particular those theories and the fellowship year, I've been able to really see how that ties in a broader, a broader kind of geographic context. Yes.
All right. So in your presentation, and thank you for that, you highlighted other spaces, other parks, right? And so you highlighted, for example, the space in Austin. In your research, did you see, because obviously they went in different directions, did you have an opportunity to kind of question some of the histories of those other spaces that you went to and see some of the strengths in terms of how that community went about the, development of those parks and those spaces, like the Booker T. Washington, Emancipation Park, for example?
So, I would actually love to take a trip out to Mejia and check it out, but I don't know when that's going to happen. I did look at, for example, the Booker T. Washington Emancipation Park has a super, a really active Facebook page, which is maintained by community members. But when you go to that page, one thing that I noticed, are people talking about, and not in a negative way, but for example, commenting that, oh, my grandchildren are playing on the same playground equipment that I played on. Or thinking about buildings in that park that were lost to fire that were never redeveloped. And so, you know, as I mentioned, I think there's a lot of different factors. You know, for example, the purchasing power of the community in Houston that rallied around Emancipation Park versus the one in Mahia is, you know, incredibly different. But also, you know, I think it's a testament, again, to kind of the incredible, kind of radical forward-thinking nature of Houston's Emancipation Park's founders, but then also the, you know, another geography to bring in, this kind of geography of support and community development that's persisted in Houston with the Friends of Emancipation Park, with the Conservancy, and with other groups that just simply refused to allow the park to fall into disrepair, even when it was being ignored by the city, even when, you know, redevelopment stopped in the 1970s. There was just this incredible resistance by constituents and other people in Houston to allow that park space to vanish. And so I think that, yeah, it's just a testament to organizing, I guess. But then also being proactive and recognizing upfront the kind of obstacles that come to historic preservation in Houston and being proactive about working around those.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you for your work. Do you plan or have you given this presentation at Emancipation Park?
So, that's a very good question. I had been in touch with, for example, groups like Third Ward Community Clock, who organize events at Emancipation Park. I have been in touch with the Conservancy itself. And so one thing that I'm looking forward to seeing is how that relationship can develop further over the next few months.
Regina, what has been your observations around community perception of the park? Like this notion of psychogeography in Black spaces have one layer of meaning that gives rise to a sense of place. This is mine, this is just me, this is something I'm proud of or not. Versus the actual use or management of the space. Some criticize the current park for its inaccessibility because it's being actively managed versus actively used. And how have you inquired about that? And what are you learning about that?
So I had that question asked to me by a friend of mine. What the park looked like prior to the redevelopment and was around what was being, like you said, actively used, and thinking about the events and the accessibility of the old park space, which is strikingly different to the space now in all of the ways that you just mentioned. And so one of the reasons that I reached out to Michelle Barnes to be part of my brain trust is not only is she a wealth of knowledge, but because Michelle has such deep roots in, for example, the Third Ward Community Clock, which, you know, I'm very grateful to them for their generosity of their time in conversation, but they really helped me to observe and understand the dynamics and how use versus accessibility has shifted with the new park. I think there are a lot of community organizations that are very interested and anxious in seeing how that relationship is going to develop now that the park has a new ED, for example, and now that the Conservancy seems to be doing some more active programming. But I know that, for example, even the process of trying to plan an event at the park has dramatically shifted. It's now online, there's a lot of paperwork. Some of that can be off-putting to smaller organizations. There's a lot of requirements that you have to meet up front, and also the facilities have changed in the community center building itself. And so those are all very real conversations that I don't want to, I'm trying to observe and see how that goes. I have my own opinions on that, but I'm definitely trying to be an observer. But no, but those are very real concerns, and I think it's something that I am also anxious to see how that develops over the next months while I continue to work on the research.
Last question.
Just to feedback on that, that's a really good question. Have you observed the impetus for stewardship from that legacy conservancy group to people to continue the care and upkeep of the park?
Sure. So I've been in touch with several people from the Friends of Emancipation Park group that was was organized and made state the case with the city for the need for redevelopment. But, you know, the conservancy was incorporated a few years ago, and so I know that they're now kind of the official stewardship group. And so I know that Friends of Emancipation Park is definitely still active, but those dynamics have changed. And I think that that's part of the reason why the use and accessibility issues have shifted as well, because that relationship with the former Friends of group, which was very much formed by community members and constituents that directly used the park, has changed into something else.